I can sound full of myself, but I can tell you that I'm glad to make money doing this, but I'm doing it because I love music, and this is what I would do anyway. And if I had to work at McDonald's to make music at night, that's what I would do.
When I first started Nine Inch Nails, I wanted it to be a band, but I couldn't find anybody to be in a band. And I was back in Cleveland, and there wasn't anybody that really kind of was thinking along the same terms I was. So reluctantly, I just thought I'd do it myself, and then it turned out pretty good, leading me into the problem of how am I going to play live. And I wanted to get a band together to play live, and I wanted it not to be me in a tape deck, but me with a visceral live band playing behind me. And then I found, pleasantly surprised to find the songs back then translated well live, and the format of it being a rock band with a real drummer and guitar, bass, it seemed to, this is a good idea. And I wanted to present it as a band, you know, even though I played the record myself, I wanted it to be come across as a band. It seemed more exciting to me. And it was a way to hide, kind of, too, you know. Kind of the same reason it's not the Trent Reznor band, you know, it's just, I don't want it that, you know. So that format's kind of continued up until on this record I did it myself and wanted to get a new band together. Just to kind of start fresh, because it's been a long time since we played, and I didn't want any baggage or any remnants of what it was to kind of taint what it is now. You know, it's also weird for me because it's been a while and I'm getting older, you know, and I don't want to walk on stage and feel like I'm pretending I'm 10 years younger than I am, you know, and I was worried about that. It's been a while since we've played. And I don't want to go out and say, well, you know, hey, for what they are, they're pretty, you know, I want to kick your ass just straight up, no disclaimers in there. Well, this time around in the studio, I wasn't really, I don't feel like I was as hard on myself because I was in a much different kind of mindset. And I'd set up, you know, I was working a little bit with Rick Rubin as kind of a mentor capacity, and he'd encourage this kind of safe environment to try things out and, you know, kind of nurturing, no bad idea type situation that really worked out well. So I didn't, the editorial part of me was kind of on hold for a while, and I allowed myself to try some things. And as I was working, I liked a lot of what was coming out, so I just let it roll, and I didn't spend a lot of time really agonizing over, as much as I remember doing that in the past. So at the end, I wound up with a lot of stuff I did like, and I knew that I could be editorial later and decide what was good or bad, but I didn't, right at the beginning, I wasn't quite as much of a dictator as I have been in the past. And I think a lot of that came from, I think a lot of me doing that in the past was just because I was so afraid of a lot of things. I was afraid of my lack of talent. I was afraid of maybe this isn't any good. I was just afraid. Fear really governed a lot of what my work was. Up to this point, it feels the process felt very different this time around. You're keeping in step in the line. Got your chin held high and you feel just fine, 'cause you do what you're told. In the past, I would, especially on the Fragile and even Downward Spiral, I would go in a studio and write in the studio, and I would just kind of, the writing and the production and the arranging and the sound design all took place at the same time. And I would start with a sound or an idea or a texture or a vision or a description and nurture it until I could fit a song into it.
In some ways, it's an interesting kind of journey. It's like I'm able to stop other parts of my life to really just see what happens if you go as far as you can go down a certain path. And that path might lead to somewhere else, and yes, nothing's holding me back from trying that. the price you pay kind of is you become very unbalanced as a human being. And you also start to realize kind of in retrospect that maybe the reason you're doing that is because you're running away from the life you don't know how to live. There's all these things I thought, well, I'll get to that someday, like, you know, a family or real friends or, you know, learning other things, how to do things in life.
Or dealing with this thing that you haven't dealt with.
Yeah, that I've been running away by hiding in a studio. So I'm much more consciously aware of those things I do.
I came out to L.A. I set up a room with only really a piano and a drum machine, kind of a four-track-ish type setup, and set a deadline of, say, every 10 days I'm going to write two songs with finished vocals and lyrics. And it forced me not to get too finicky with the arrangement and the sound design, which I could go off forever tweaking sounds. I enjoy doing that. But writing words and melodies, that's hard. So I find that I avoid it if I can. And I can make up, I can feel like I'm busy by filling myself with clutter that I don't need to do. It sounds like this record is more song-based to me. And it sounds like each song could stand on their own a little better than a song off The Fragile could stand on its own, which those songs sound good to me if they have three or four of their friends around them to support them. And this is less about a big epic thing and more about a collection of smaller epics, you know. So it feels that aspect of it feels differently to me.
I'm becoming less defined as days go by, fading away. Well, you might say I'm losing focus, kind of drifting into the abstract.
I've said somewhere that I thought this record was more honest than ones I've done in the past. And every record I've done at the time seems like the most honest work I could do. But I can look back to how I did some of the old albums and realize that I was so afraid during a lot of that, so unsure of myself, or so kind of worried about what the world might think, that it push me in a way that was limiting somehow.
I get off the tour bus 2.5 years later, and in my head I'm thinking I'm going to return to being the real me, but the real me isn't the real me anymore, and maybe never was me, and who am I now? Am I the guy that's on stage that I read about? And my whole personality had been distorted, and all kinds of external things had come into my world, and people around me that weren't the right, you know, just weird, you know, behind the music scenarios that you see happening to your own life. And there's a reason that everybody's career does the same thing, you know, that you're human. Lately, I've come to terms with I'm not saying I hope to be alone the rest of my life, but I think everybody is alone, really, you know, and I'm a lot more comfortable with who I am or my head. I'm not real comfortable with being treated as a celebrity all the time. I don't think it's good for your soul to be around that. I don't think once you start believing the hype and that you're, you know, in any way more important than anyone else, I think that starts to really corrode a part of you that's important to keep in touch with.
So this time around, I felt like some shackles had been freed. And as a person, I was carrying a lot less baggage around with me. And I think it all kind of translated into a different, more liberating creative experience. You know, if you'd asked me that question, what state of mind produces my best work, 10 years ago, I would have said pain and despair and desperation and aggravation. And given the choice to punch a wall or write a song, I'd have to be in that mindset to get something out that mattered, or utter defeat. Or one of those things was the motivation to channel that energy into something that might be considered positive instead of self-destructive. And I think what I learned on this record was that I can create without relying on that thing. And I don't need to be in a place of wanting to kill myself to write a song. And in fact, not being in that place allows me to think a lot more clearly about things than I could if I have to be in that place to write. You know? And I was wary of creating in sobriety. I didn't know how that was going to work, or if it could work, or if I was one of those tragic figures that
has to rely on whatever to get to whatever state to get, you know. And much like every other role that drugs or alcohol played in my life, I realized that that also was more hindering than it was freeing. And then that, a lot of that was a lie and a cheap way to get to some place. It wasn't real anyway. You know, and I can function much better creatively as well as, you know, in life in general. Hey,
Downward Spiral tour, which took a long time, it was over 2 years of touring. And then I went right into doing a Manson album, and I found myself pretty disenchanted with everything. And musically, I wasn't really sure what I wanted to do, and the business side of music I started hating, and I realized what my job had become. I really disliked what it turned into on a number of levels. So when I started The Fragile, it was about me rediscovering that I love music and forgetting about all the crap that comes with it, but just getting back to really making music. And I felt that I'd kind of emerged from the downward spiral somewhat in a somewhat damaged state. And I wanted to make a record that wasn't made of steel and it wasn't invulnerable, but it wasn't a tough thing. It was frail by its nature. And the title came first. And then I just started exploring my own subconscious, see what came out. And it turned into this sprawling thing that I thought would be fairly long, demanding listen of people. But that's what I really wanted to do. So Down Sprawl came out at the end of 94. And we spent 2 years promoting that record by touring. And the decision to do that was based on we didn't have any other really concrete means of promoting the record. So we didn't have radio, we didn't have MTV necessarily. So we, the only thing we could do is tour. And I thought we did that well, and I knew I could make the tour good on my own. So we toured and toured and toured. And the result of that was 2 long years on a tour bus where your world became a bit distorted and you're surrounded by people that either kiss your ass or we started as a medium-sized band in America. When we ended up, we were a big band. Mm-hmm. And I really didn't, my head was spinning when I got off that tour. And I allowed some external forces to kind of shape my own personality, and I became something I said I never would be. You know, I turned into someone I didn't like that much. And how that explains why it took so long to make the next record is 2 years spent touring. Then I finished that. I went right into producing the Manson Antichrist Superstar record, which took a lot longer than we thought it would. Mm. And that finished, and I found myself in a space that was a pretty bad place, actually, like emotionally and spiritually, where I was really just genuinely unhappy. And I've realized that as an artist, I have to draw upon a place where I have to examine myself and really try to understand why I feel the way I do about certain things and have the courage to look into that mirror and see it. And now, in retrospect, I look back to that time and I realized the last thing I wanted to do was do that. The last person I wanted to spend time with was myself at that time. So I did anything I could to not do that. I took on projects like Lost Highway, like Natural Born Killers, anything that made me think I was busy, but I wasn't really addressing the situation. And it took me getting to a place of like being at the bottom and really having the courage to face myself and say, you know, you got everything you ever want in life, and you're miserable. And that made me feel worse because I had no excuses. Like, I get everything I ever dreamed I'd ever get because I never thought I'd get it. I got it. And I think where my head was at was trying to attain a sense of order, but knowing that it was flawed and fatal at the same time and tragic. I have some sense of you trying to keep things together. I can think in the song The Fragile, I did that the best to me, where it was coming from a point of view of trying to help somebody or save something or preserve something, but you're on no firm ground to stand on yourselves. Years ago when I did the music that was going to be Pretty Hate Machine, I'd always wanted to be in a band, I thought, and I wanted to do this, I thought. And when I finally had the courage to sit down and try to write music, first I just tried to write lyrics just to have lyrics to put in a song. They didn't mean anything, they were bad. And it wasn't until I had the courage to kind of, I realized I was keeping a journal of like things that I wouldn't show anybody, and things I wasn't really proud to feel, but I had to get it out somehow. And so when I incorporated them into a few songs, and I realized that I'd struck something that made me feel better to get it out, and it had an honesty and an integrity to it that I think can only come from meaning something instead of pretending that you're a character doing something. So I kind of used that as the framework for Nine Inch Nails, where every record I've done really expresses where my head's been at when I've done it.
Do you mind if we just go out to the window and say hi to some of your fans? Cool.
My last, the last times I played, the last year of touring in 2000 was being sick every single day and lying to myself and living in this terrifying world of being physically addicted to something. If I didn't have a drink before I went on, I'd get sick, and it was just terrible. And that was soul-crushing year, facing, just bad time. And I got to admit, the day of the first show, I woke up nervous, and it wasn't like I want to go have a drink. It was just like, I hope I don't feel that way before I go on stage, And I didn't, I went on, and it was a great show, and the next day I kind of thought about it, but not really, and then I didn't even think about it. It just became how I remember it being before that last year of touring. It was something to look forward to, and it's fun playing live, and it's great to look out and know that I can't wait to play these songs for you, and I'm not dying on stage while I'm doing it, which, no complaints right now. Music's always been a way for me to try to feel better and get better, but I think the inspiration is coming from a less destructive place than it used to be. My life really just kind of crashed and burned. I got, I had to come to terms with being an addict, you know, which was something that I'd for a long time lied to myself about the status of, until it really was, I couldn't lie anymore because I was either going to die or I had to get better. And there wasn't any, I couldn't go forward. And so a few years ago, I did what I needed to do to get my life in order and took the time off because I didn't know if I wanted to do this anymore, because I'd wound up in a terrible, terrible place and I wasn't sure what got me there, and I wasn't sure if I could even still write or if I had anything to say. And it came out of it was incredibly therapeutic because I found that, well, I can write and now I can actually think again and I like myself again and I'm more enthused about working than I think I've ever been, and I feel like I'm not kind of anchored to this black cloud that's going to take me down, you know, that's going to descend on me. Hi, Trent Reznor here from Nine Inch Nails, and I thought I would talk a little bit about a new record I have coming out called Year Zero. When we were touring for With Teeth, I found myself with some time on my hands and kind of anxious to try things out. So I started writing music on the road, and I set up a laptop situation that was pretty inspiring to work on. And found that anytime I had some free time, whether it be backstage or before a show or on a bus, I could churn out little snippets of things. And in that process, I stumbled into the thing that felt really inspiring to me, the direction. So I took a little bit of time and, as a kind of writing experiment, tried to imagine what the world might be like in the future, maybe 15 years or so in the future. And again, just as an experiment, I wrote out a synopsis of what life might be like in that time, politically, relationship-wise, the state of current events, the state of the world, ecologically, spiritually. And it felt like a pretty real thing, and I started to think about, started to live in that world in my head a bit, and started to write some songs to see what it turned out like from different points of view of people that might be in that situation, with varying opinions. And again, the fuse felt like it was lit, and in a relatively short amount of time, in a few months, I had an entire album worth of material. I took the music I'd been working on and married it with these new lyric ideas, and it really felt like this had a laser sharp focus. It felt like a piece of work, not so much a collection of songs, but a larger thing. It's really a continuation of themes we've done in Nine Inch Nails, of something that's organic and imperfect, pace of the dialogue and the way it looks. There was a good moment of panic where we had to think, what is music going to do in this? You know, there's no sweeping landscapes to fill out with sound and battle scenes, you know. How do we put ourselves in the role of the Zuckerberg character, someone that doesn't feel like they fit in, trying to validate themselves by pursuing a great idea and screwing some people over in the process? I can relate to all those things, you know, and I've had versions of that in my own life. We had close to 2 hours worth of music we sent to him, said, just see if anything's close, thinking we'd have three or four waves of that off the bat, but he came back and said, it's the best first draft I've ever had.
For instance, Hand Covers Bruise, you know, that we worked on the bed, and then Trent was like, well, let me try something on the piano.
we show up to the screening with maybe 50 to 100 people or something like that on the lot at Sony.
And Brad Pitt was there, right?
He was sitting in front of us, and it's already weird, right? And then the film comes on, and we hear Hand Covers Bruise in that slot. And it literally was one of those goosebump moments, like, that was equal to any great moment I've had in my career. You know, being on stage at Woodstock, kind of in slow motion. It had that same kind of feeling. David came up to us and said, I think your score made the film, and I think it's amazing, but I wouldn't hold my breath in terms of awards season because it's not the type of score that traditionally gets a nod for this. And I said, oh, well, I'm not even, never even crossed my mind, honestly.